that in here?
Huh?
Speak up, man.
Got it.
English way, yeah, we not, we are now. I'm with.
So yesterday,
You talk about types of listening. We dwell much on two types of listening: informational listening, as well as affectional listening, or effective listening. You say informational listening is the process of information listening that focuses on the ability of an individual to understand the speaker's message. Effective listening, by saying it mainly involves two stages. This one is seeking further time to figure the idea, and the second one is pretty much to do with offering the feedback. We went on to look at the categories of types of listening to identify discriminative, critical, evaluative, empathic, appreciative, as well as self-seeking.
Thank you.
Yeah, so there are three notable skills that will aid you to be a great listener. First one, not taking. Second one, effective questioning. And lastly, verbal communication. We have probably learned about not taking in secondary school. Anyone who remembers anything about it? Not taking. I think it was the young man. Last time we met, you said, oh, what's the difference between not taking and not taking? I think we discussed it. Trade class in the world. Anyway, not taking is very much about listening actively as opposed to listening passively. So, the most important thing involves making sense of what the speaker is saying and paying attention to the main point as well as the subordinate point. But I've emphasized something on the last point, which I don't know if you can read. I'm saying it is rather a selection, and it needs to be organized, and it will include the most important or interesting part of the lecture that you have been listening to. I'll just use the lecture, but it could be any person. It could be a preacher, it could be the person that you are interviewing, it could be the head of the family or whatsoever. When I was introducing this topic, I made it clear that this chapter that we're talking about active listening is most important, showing the importance of the listener to be not passive but rather active in decoding whatever the speaker said. When I use the elements of communication, I say in the seminar, the method, the medium, the receiver, the speaker. And usually, the elder scholars, they used to say that the receiver of the method is passive. And if you go to mass communication or generally, if you ask your friends in mass communication or journalism, they generally do it. Here is the course of journalism. Yeah, if you ask them, they will tell you that initially there was a theory that was called the magic bullet theory. In the magic bullet theory, they used to say that the receiver of the message in media is passive. And because the receiver is passive, anything that happens in the media, in television, on the radio, or in the newspaper, the receiver of the message simply absorbs it. In other words, the magic bullet was that someone is firing a bullet at you using a gun, and there's nothing that you can do about it. Simply penetrate. In other words, for example, if there are people shooting each other in the television, the magic bullet theory, the idea is that the people will simply also start taking guns and shooting each other. However, other people argue and say, no, that's not the case. Because people select what they feel like they should absorb and what they shouldn't absorb. For example, when you watch Jackie Chan or Jet Li or whoever fighting each other, it's not everyone who starts fighting. They are friends. Some people say, no, this is not true. And this is fine. The same way, there are a lot of movies or videos that you watch. But after watching, you don't do what those people are doing. So they said, no, the people ask you participants in the process of communication. And the people that oppose magic bullet theory, they came up with usage and modification theory. It is the one that says no, people decide what they should do. And this part also follows the same thing. When you are listening to a presentation, a speech, or whatsoever, or an interview in your case, and you're interviewing people, when they are talking to you, it doesn't make you fascinated with it. Rather, you become active in decoding the message that they are giving to you. And that is the point that I'm stressing down here. Now, take note. We are both taking down everything. You've got down the notes. Pretty much this is a revision. I think you already know most of this. You've got down the notes to take by using symbols, abbreviations, shorthand, blah, 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 blah. I've given an example of shorthand, leaving out vowels, cutting off the end of the word. Yes, those are just some of the examples. E.g., I've used E.g. As a point that is introducing those examples, but even E.g. itself is an example of shorthand. Constructive elaborations, multi-stage. I've given you a source for your reading. This one, you can always use that. And read something about not checking. Well, we can copy that and paste it. You can always find a lot of stuff. And last time I introduced you to Google Scholar as well. You can also check that out. Also, guys, we use, there are a couple of ways, so I'm giving you some of them. So you use the colon not checking system. You will replace that too. Then you will write down note. If. Then you write your own one. But you found out about the colon not checking. You identify yourself in list of key points. So later on we'll see how you can find those key points, but usually the speakers will tell you that they are going to the key point. And they will tell you the number. The steps for getting the ready step. Number one, because you literally know that that's the big one. Some people say first, second, third. But you can also draw a diagram. I think we are also familiar with this. Other people use flow charts to make their own idea. This is my point, this is my point, this is my point. When you are doing, I remember when you are doing composition writing, anything of that kind. That's what our teacher told us. So, come up with a topic, put it there, put something there, put things there, put things there, just let what you want to connect. A lot of ways you will find out for yourself and grow. Those are just some of the examples that can help you to come up with this point. And organize your notes. An example of a diagram, this is the flowchart of quite what I've been learning. I started with listening skills in the chapter. I talked about that is listening skills, and I'm giving you those skills of communication, effective questioning, and verbal communication. That's an example of how you can make one. So you would say, okay, the speaker in this case, to me, suddenly that was this cube and topic, and I came up with a topic, I think this is a cube, then I came up with my self-pollinating voice. That's an example of taking off. So if you are somewhere interviewing someone, and you feel like the flow of how you want to get information, because when you go back, you want to use that kind of information, this is another thing.
Okay.
Alright? Remember taking off using your own words and your own thoughts in the process of taking and making notes. It helps you so that you relate with the past. Some people use big words, an example is how it is. They use big words when they go home and you read, glued to your dictionary, trying to find the meaning. So use your own words and try to get the whole point. There's a point there, I think all these skills learned in this section apply to taking notes from books and other academic materials. You also apply to interviews and so on and so forth. This point is the same to be told. I use this material for a different class. So don't worry about that. But yeah, it also applies to interviews, it applies to listening to speeches, and so on and so forth. So remember to develop a way that works for you. This is very subjective, what works for her, and what works for her, and what works for him, and so on and so forth. Alright. This is questioning is number two. The first one was what? Alright. Effective questioning is number two. I think effective questioning is another important skill and active listening that you need to acquire in order to open it to your study life and activities and the work of other people. Most of the time, you need to know more what the people are thinking, wanting, planning. Asking questions helps you to focus and concentrate more on what you're speaking. So one reason why we ask questions is when they study, we just find out about other people, but it's also the way of directing your conversation towards something. When asking questions, for example, generally when you ask a question, you build up the questions to try to get to a climax, to somewhere where I want people to reveal themselves. Okay, so you start slow, you start smoothly, you welcome the people. The same way yesterday, I think I introduced formative and what? And reflective. So then, in informative, you're a bit warm. The questioning and everything is a bit light and shallow. But when you go to reflective, you are going deep and try to really find out a lot of things and people get emotional, people get angry and so on and so forth. It's the same way with effective questioning. Much as you want to understand other people's attitude, feelings, and so on and so forth, but you are also trying to direct the conversation to get it to your certain language. And in doing this, there are two major categories of questions. One closed question, another one is open ended question. We know these things. An example of a closed question, just one example anymore. An example of a closed question.
Are you okay?
What's the answer to that?
Yes.
Or?
Okay.
Yes or?
No.
So that's a very good question because that's where I want to Another answer to an open question could be an answer of the question. Answer that I just dictified. True or false? Maybe true or false? Yeah, so those are examples of closed questions. An example of open-ended question. If we answer this one, then there is no need to go wrong with this. Another example, an example of open-ended question. An example of open-ended question.
You would?
No, no, that's really. I know that is my next sound. Yes. Yeah.
Oh,
why did you do that? Anyway, so what is the sound?
Are you?
Something different. Okay, what's the difference between open-ended and closed questions? Closed questions, you are directing someone to answer a question yes, no, true, false, right, left, right, wrong, up, down, left, right, something like that. But for the open-ended question, you want someone to explain. Open-ended. You want to explain yourself. How do you feel about me being your lecturer? So it's not yet. Not no. It's that thing. I feel like you're the worst lecturer I've ever had. You sit down quite a lot and you come late and blah blah blah. So you're trying to explain a lot of things. Yeah. But that's it about open-ended. It's the same thing. You, if you be doing your research, it'll be up to where you'll be asking people those questions. Then be a part of you'll be asking people the same way in be interviewing people in your field, in your career, you have open questions, you also have questions. So you ask, for example, a child or whoever, how are you staying at this? The answer can be just right. You want an explanation about that. I know everything here is fine, they treat me well, they eat good food 3 times a day, some of them did that, blah, 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 blah. Of course, I have a cousin who loves me, but it's normal, you know, things like that. So you'll be getting a lot of information from that. Anyway, those questions are those that invite yes or no responses. Those questions tend to shut people up rather than letting them open up. For example, did you like the food, the movie, the speech, the job, the theater? It's different from how did you like that movie? First one is an example of open question. Second one is an example of open question. Also consider the difference between 2 versions of the same question. Well, John, do you want to go ahead and adopt the old historian again? What would be the answer to that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The other one, well, John, how do you feel about adopting the way we say it? So someone here was asking,
yeah, I feel like it's a good idea. And I wonder, the language was achieved to last for you, so, the drama, how well I'm going to feel this thing, how well I'm going to feel this thing.
Yeah, but I've also stressed the point there to say, some questions, rather, I mean, closed questions tend to push someone to accept an answer. You don't want to waste a lot of time. You want to jump to another question. So you're trying to push that person to stay here and yes. According to how it is structured, your question. I think we have said all that. So you can go back to all that. Yeah, so then you get around to it. If you want to find a little information about this, the structure of the question, so that it should be open to the question. That's how you know it. But if you want to jump from one question to the other, try to move quickly. Then it's deep to the question. Alright. That's an explanation about the various questions. Those are some of the advantages of the benefit of using open-ended questions. It helps you solve problems in a way that makes the shape of the meaning. Help you to understand subjects better than people around you. Getting rich and more satisfying conversation about academic information. I'm moving really fast because I know you guys will have this. I've always given to such a thing. So, more examples of open-ended questions. How comfortable are you with planning? How to learn and modify this proposal and need more advice. What kind of information do you need in order to move forward? How are you feeling about all this? How ready are you to do this without doing that? So the answer to this question can be yes, can be no, can be true, can be false. You need a bit of an explanation. How to ask questions more creatively? What sort of questions are truly worth asking? Unlike the questions that we throw through our usual conversation, our usual interaction, in your field of study or in your career, structuring questions is a crush, is a skill, deliberately designed to get the best responses that you require from your client. So it's just your normal way of asking questions, but because you're specific, there is something that you want to get from your client. Structure your questions in a way that will help you to get your responses. A brutal point that I've raised on the second dot is that nevertheless, many of the questions that we have learned to ask are totally fruitless and self-defeating. For example, a question that is asked by a parent or a pregnant teen. Why? Why have you done this to us? How do you respond to that? Imagine you are a girl and you heard that. Pretty much there's no one who has given an answer to this kind of question. So that's not how you structure a question. Because this question is asked, you ask this one not to get a response. The parents don't ask you. If you get a response, you're being rude. That's like that. You're not supposed to run away. The moment they ask you, they don't do that. You can say, because I was expecting. That's the point. So these are some of the questions that we tend to ask that we don't really want to get responses. And these are the kind of questions that you tend to ask. the scripture in question, in the last part of the day, it is pretty much better to ask the hard questions that give you a reasonable answer about the future than the why that we do about only the question of God. For example, how do you tend to move forward with this pregnancy? How do you tend to go on with your education if you are this pregnant? How do you tend to go on with the intent to stay here from the man who is defeated? So that was an example of a question that usually is fruitless, baseless, and it is really white. There are so many creative possibilities as well. In the beauty of the questions we may ask, not all are equally fruitful or illuminating. Not all are equally helpful for the problems of the world. Many such conscious, fruitful questions provide oneself and about one's situation or task is an important part of the training of many professions. I think there should be a different program. There should be a course that should be in mind for social work. I've made some announcements. Have you encountered any document to do with your mind on how to address it and how to work together? Anyway, so yeah, that's about we also talked about nonverbal communication within the faith. Number one, the faith is what? The what? Note-taking. Number two. And number two, we have nonverbal communication. We have talked quite a lot about nonverbal communication. I remember, I think my example was involved in this. I gave an example of, when you're trying to take something and the dog runs away. That's a nonverbal communication. So it's a word-based communication, pretty much goes on signs, facial expressions, and what have you. Eye contact, posture. For example, posture. A posture is different. Shows like what? Yes, it's not. That's a nonverbal communication. So nonverbal communication can be communicated through object communication, such as clothing, hairstyle, or even architecture, inroads, and simple breath. If you follow movies, what color is dominant in the world?
Blue and white.
Blue and white. More especially white. Water.
Yellow.
What color is associated with it? Those are the things that will, be looked at. That's nonverbal communication. Even in the movies, if you are watching movies, to do with war, and the war is in Iran or Pakistan, is, because there's a lot of heat, so it's different from London. London, the color is cold, it's so many. If you are watching a thing in a movie that shows that player, what is it come up in that movie? Is it worth it to be
because they present women as weak.
Tamat begitu.
Life to
put a man bigger. So a man is related to masculinity. That's how they present it, because they are presenting their product to a culture that believes that men are
men.
So it's not just about, you know, it's about Bungoli Sapapo and so on and so forth. So it's those kind of things that kind of shift our society.
When it's not true, that doesn't mean that they all men are strong. It doesn't mean that all men are white. It doesn't mean that all men deserve respect. Okay? Not all men that deserve respect. True or
false?
Why? Why not? The Why not? Because pretty much one appreciates men for women. If it's the attribute, not the brain. Okay. We're pretty much the
same. So if the man is not masculine, he doesn't deserve respect.
Okay, the what?
If the man is not masculine.
No, the issue is not necessarily about masculinity,
because it's not a measure of respect. You can
be masculine, but so stupid, isn't it?
You're not doing it.
Yeah, so it's a different
thing. Yeah, it's a different thing. So it's a hot topic because we have grown up in a society where all our sources are not going to be disputed and you really don't have, you know, and the lady has to be. When you go in class, I think I mean that I don't want to go to class. When you go, you can see your how many women you have. For example, first institution, you must see one of us has to intimate, you know, wherever people have been employed by them. So they are more successful than me, you know. And that's the trend. That's what I was saying even about my cultural communication. Say, we have just grown up to say that. I think we are going to go down that thing and go to one of them. I go to one of them. I am. You know, all these things are just revolving around us. So when you get to an interview, find a Yao, brilliant Yao there, whether you don't know what you because your perception is a Yao. You're talking about it. Whether you don't know what you do, because you feel like that kind of idea. And it's not always the same. It's not always the same. So people look at features. And you start making the that's not a verbal communication. That's why it's very crucial. It's very crucial to your style because you don't have a material reality. Yes. So you shouldn't start making judgments before you start talking. So you can't say we mean a particular thing. We did a radical. That's why I'd rather not have it in Mahuri. I've never heard of that. I'm just being. But you haven't seen in that tribe and seen each and every man who went and found out what they were doing. So you get there and you jump into the idea. Your conclusion is that. Some of the victims. Another example of what we call hasty generalization, you may have moved at it, just to put it in a narrative. The ladies say, oh, me and a dog. So,
I know.
You see, so those are the things they generalize. Everyone is sitting here. So it's that kind of communication. But all these are non-verbal communication. You go to a man or you go to a lady, and have a way of going to the sister, or the lady, or the sister. You know, those are non-verbal communication. The book of Saeed, non-verbal communication. Someone is talking, William X said, non-verbal communication. I like that one quite a bit. You know,
And more especially when I go to my home village. Because there are a lot of villages sitting at the line. So I was afraid of being a native Sabina or this. But it's very dangerous. When I go home, pretty much everyone is our relative. Every person is outside. If I'm with my mom, she will leave her to me.
Just your uncle speaks as me, but it's not fine.
So we are related. So that's how it works. So, put on the head and you move up there.
Oh, I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
I can excuse, but it's rude. Otherwise, I'm going to try. Yeah, so all those are non-verbal communication. By the way, about my mom, I called her yesterday, video call. We haven't met in 2 years. So she looked at my beard, and she said I should share my beard. I said, I'll ask my student. Because that was the game, good game. Anyway, that's verbal communication. Closing. That's on what we have. Man, I have a tough figure with the closing issue. When they come here, they even in the long dress, they be killed. And so on and so forth. And when I asked one, I was at a PC when I was doing my undergraduate. I brought up some very old questions. And there are a lot of wives that came with 10 visits for education or whatever. And one of them dressed like that, so I was asking, what do you dress like? Do you dress like this? I said,
hey, no, look at my picture, you know.
And she was dressed like that. So I said, why? So she said, when you come to Africa, more especially Malawi, to get education about that country. So she was told that we have nobody from the meaning that people waste on the name of blah. So that's the kind of question that gets. And so I said, no, this is not a good idea. Not really happening and all that kind of stuff. So that's kind of the communication that they bring. Oh, Malawi, Angola, or Katumba, or Jani, become the thing. So they are taught to their style. Just recently, there was a ruling by the government, which is not constitutional, for the Maratha, or Anna Maratha, or something like that. Who followed that? So, yeah. So now it's a law. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. To the Frenchman. So they won the case and that is what it is. Because they wanted to make it a law because of non-verbal communication. And when you look at Mana or the non-verbal law in the class, initial, what is the belief of Java? Yeah, I was like, what are you looking at? Yeah, so initially, the thing don't make it true. Yeah. So they're trying to make it constitutional, which is somehow make it that way. It shouldn't be favored or obsolete or this kind of stuff. However, a few other people argue, okay. Maratha liberation. And Hindu and liberation the average. And Shaolini and liberation the average. Then the Muslims, the hijab and all that. And now imagine the class is a child attack. So there's still debate about all those things. But the issue about all that is unfair for the question. And so on and so on. Architecture, example of my architecture and domain of America. We talked about talked about land and bridge, and so on and so forth. And the building, then I go to our own, and I'm like, ah, that's all. I'm on a picture, and I
Which I use